Why do we do what we do? It's a great question. For some, they do according to the human nature. They do what feels good to them. They do what they want to do. And in many cases, not all, but in many cases, they do not think of the consequences. Never crosses their mind. Then there's another segment of the population who live by means of faith in the promises that God gave in Jesus Christ. And because they do, they want to honor God by what they do here on earth. They know the consequences. They know what is right and wrong. They live, A, according to forgiveness, B, according to obedience. We're going to get into that today here in our episode of The Word. We're going to talk about our life and its consequences. Stay tuned. We'll be right back.
Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path.
Our life and its consequences. Every person. Now, you may not agree with me. Fine. You may not. But you are experiencing life, and life has consequences, both good and bad. Now, you may choose to ignore said consequences, good or bad, but it doesn't mean your life does not have consequences. Your actions, whatever you choose to do, will have some kind of effect on both your life and someone else. Now, if you remember yesterday, where we were yesterday, we were talking about Paul's chastisement about lawsuits, taking issues and challenges that were designed to be taken care of in-house, that were designed to be taken care of by the people of God, because it is the people of God who are to help the people of God to judge, in a sense, although that word does not work well in that consequence. Anyway, moving away from that. The interesting thing is, we don't take our challenges, our consequences, outside of the realm of the church. We try to handle them within the church. And Paul says, do you not know that it is us, the church, who will be the actors of judgment, of God's judgment upon the world? Not the world judging us, but we judging the world. It'll be a complete reversal. That's part of what we went over yesterday. Now, today, we're going to take a deeper dive into that kind of a context. So if you have your Bibles ready and open, we are going to look at, we're going to start, I think I'll pick it up at verse 7 in the part where we left off yesterday, and we will carry it through until verse 11. This is going to be a short section because I don't want to get too deep further and not have enough time to dedicate here on these words Paul is going to write. Okay, so 1 Corinthians 6, we're going to start at verse 7, go through verse 11. All right. To have lawsuits at all with one another is already a defeat for you. Why not rather suffer wrong? Why not rather be defrauded? But you yourselves wrong and defraud even your own brothers. Or do you not know that the unrighteous will not inherit the kingdom of God? Do not be deceived. Neither the sexually immoral, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor men who practice homosexuality, nor thieves, nor the greedy, nor drunkards, nor revilers, nor swindlers will inherit the kingdom of God. and such were some of you. But you were washed, you were sanctified, you were justified in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and by the Spirit of our God. And you know, you look at this and you say, yes, I used to be that. Yes, I used to practice sexual sins. There's a few listed. Paul's words are clear enough. I don't need to add anything to those. But there's a few things I want to add. He's not just picking on one commandment. Thou shalt not commit adultery. He's not picking on that. Let's look at this, okay? Let's look at these, all these through. Sexually immoral, nor idolaters. Again, these are words he's already used earlier in the chapter, if you recall, a couple of episodes previous. And maybe if this is the first time, I'm sorry you're walking in on this one. But you can go back to three, maybe four episodes, but no more than three episodes of the word to kind of roll you into. So you can do a little binge watching, binge studying if you have the time today, or even if you have some time this evening with your family and friends. But it would be good for you, if this is the first one, for you to catch up. Okay. Back. Okay. Do you not know the unrighteous? There's your trigger word right there in verse 9. Do not know the unrighteous will not inherit the kingdom of God. The unright, the not right. Not right according to whose standards? God's. Like I said in the preview, in the opening, those who are of the world will be judged according to God's law, the Ten Commandments, and their lives will be put under, in a sense, a microscope by God. God will look at every aspect of your life, what you did 24/7, 365, every year of your life. That's what's written in your book, in the book of your life, when God will look at you at the end. Okay? If you are a non-believer, that's what your life will be judged by. Because as a non-believer, you are by definition unrighteous. You are not made right with God. So God will have the only standard, the one and only standard that God has for you, if you are unrighteous, is the Ten Commandments. That are the things by which you will be judged. And if you are the righteous, meaning you have been made right by God by the blood of Jesus Christ, you have been forgiven, you have been given a new life, God will look at you through Jesus-colored glasses. He will look at you through the sacrifice of what Jesus has done for you. Does that mean you get away with everything? No, there are consequences. We talked about consequences earlier in the promo. There are always going to be consequences. Yet at the same time, what God has given to you also has a consequence. It's called eternal life. It is called the kingdom of God. And so what Paul is trying to get at here is the unrighteous will not inherit the kingdom of God. Now, the unrighteousness that people exhibit all manifests themselves in different ways. Areas regarding the Ten Commandments. For example, do not be deceived in the very second half of verse 9. Do not be deceived, neither the sexually immoral nor idolaters, sexually immoral, commandment 6, you shall not commit adultery, nor idolaters, you shall have only one God, and you shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself any graven images or idols. That's commandment number 1. Nor adulterers. We're back to commandment 6. You shall not commit adultery again. Nor men who practice homosexuality. Okay. Nor thieves. Commandment number 7. You shall not steal. Nor the greedy. Again, commandment number 7. Nor drunkards. Drunkards can be labeled into a lot of different categories, but I'm going to go back to number 1 on that one. You have another God. It's called alcohol. nor revilers. Okay, going back to number one again, you're interested in yourself. Those two words can be used in a smaller subcategory called hedonism. It's all about me. Actually, all of these are all about me. Okay? And if you really boil them all down to whether you get into the commandments from 4 through 10, what one commandment is going to be broken overall? You shall have no other gods before me. Why? Because I am my own God. That's the biggest problem. That's what makes people unrighteous. Is the God of me. Okay? Nor swindlers, that's number 7 again, will inherit the kingdom of God. Okay, God is going to look at you and look at your behavior. He's going to look at you in two fundamental ways. The first fundamental way is, how did you honor me? Did you have me first and foremost in every aspect of your life, or in areas of your life where you focused only on you? Did you honor my name? Did you keep my name holy? Did you keep my name sacred, or did you use it in profanity? And were you using it to express your anger and frustration? Not a good way in which to use God's name. Did you honor the Sabbath day by keeping it holy? See, these three commandments get to the point of, where are we in relationship to God? And a sub part of the first one, you shall not make for yourself any graven images. Don't make any idols. In the Old Testament time when this was written, I mean, they were literal idols. I mean, things made out of wood or stone or metal. The idols today are self, money, power, just to name the three biggies. There's more to it, way more to it than that. The bottom line really is this. We have a part of our life is to honoring God. And then this 4 through 10 is, how do we honor each other? Jesus was asked, and I can put the reference as to Jesus asking, what is the greatest commandment? And Jesus answered, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength, and to love your neighbor as yourself. So it's all about caring for God and caring for one another. Who's on the bottom of that list, that third on the list? You are. Love your neighbor as yourself. So you honor yourself by staying away from all of these things. Okay, that sets the tone. Now, here's the other interesting phenomenon. And such were some of you. Some of you used to be that. Some of you used to live that lifestyle of self-gratification, of self-indulgence, of self-aggrandizing. Some of you used to be so selfish. And it doesn't matter in which ways your selfishness came out. It was all about you. And it's still, for the unrighteous, it's still all about you. That part hasn't changed in not only over 2,000 years, but thousands of years before that. It all became me. Think about the very first sin in the Garden of Eden. They thought it was great to have all this knowledge and to be like God. Well, there is only one God. There is no other. He is manifested in three persons, Father, Son, Holy Spirit. He is one God. He is one Lord. He is one Savior. There is no other. And it boils down all the way back to that. And people have been living in this, I'm better, I know better for me than anybody. It's all about me. And God proved that it's not all about me. It's all about everybody. And that's what Jesus came to save you from. He came to save you from yourself. and he gave up his body and he gave his blood so that you would be forgiven. And he rose from the grave to tell you that there is a new life that's living right now, a new life that is full of grace and mercy and peace and joy. And such is some of you. But you were washed, you were sanctified, made holy, you were justified, declared righteous in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and by the Spirit of our God. You were made different. And that's what it's all about. You were made different. Yes, your life now has consequences. And the consequences are you will inherit the kingdom of God. That's the positive consequence of the grace and the mercy that God has given to you. That's what it's all about. So, let's live in God's consequences. Let's set aside the human. Let's set aside the self. Let's know that the self is sinful. I mean, I could run down the whole list of any kind of thought, word, or action that we can do. But let us live according to the grace and the mercy of God that has its consequences in salvation and grace and mercy and changes our lives in that way. So, let us live according to God's grace and thereby the consequences, which means you're living in the kingdom of God. If you have any questions, comments, you know, use the comment section down at the bottom of the page. Love to hear from you. Maybe in your discussion groups a question came up. Let me know. And we'll engage in a little bit of a dialogue. You guys have a great day, great weekend. We are moving forward, getting closer and closer to Christmas, and you'll hear more about that as we get closer. You guys have a great day. I'll talk to you. Bye.